Hello everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, Isanti, you are.
Okay, so I'll start sharing my screen. Hope everyone can see my screen. Is my screen visible, guys?
Yeah, a lot of thumbs up I can see. So yes.
Okay, so the talk is about managing a large code base. We all work in our offices and are on pet projects, but at times we've seen that the code base can grow too large. The reason being we keep adding new features. We tend to go through the route of saying a service-oriented architecture. We want to break our code as much as possible, still want to leverage the benefits of working like you're working on one code base with less hassle of tracking everything. So this is about managing a large code base. And today we'll just discuss what are the options that are available to us when we have a large code base. How can we manage that large code base? So there are just few options that I will discuss. There are many more outside that we should explore and then conclude which one fits best for our project, because no one size fits all. So without further ado, I'll just quickly run through the slides. I have two demos to show you. So we'll be focusing more on the demo and the more interactions in the demo, how things are working together, that tied together. Slides, we can quickly run through. It's basic theory that every one of us probably knows it. So a monolithic code, like all of us knows, it's just one single repository. We can have a common build system, some common libraries. Of course, it has its advantages, like there is one code, you have a simple deployment process, only one repository to check out. So as simple as that. But sometimes this monolithic code has its own challenges. For example, for a very small change that you want to make in your app, you might want to repackage it, assemble it, and then publish it. And also there would be very tight coupling of, since you haven't separated your code into modules or packages, as you would say. So there tends to be a very tight coupling. And if you are trying to go through the route of, say, a bilingual or multilingual architecture wherein you want to fit, say, Angular, Vue, React, Backbone, Ember, all into one kind of an application, split, say, into services, it might pose some challenges if you're on a monolithic code. You either it's not supported at all or the support is very little. So what is the solution? Of course, all of us know solution is simple, go ahead and create packages, right? It's okay. But the main thing to know here is what should be the traits of packages. First, you should try to keep the packages as independent as possible so that there is very loose coupling between one another and you can independently manage and version all these packages. So these are the basic two traits that you should be keeping in mind, or we all should be keeping in mind when we break our code base into packages. We want them to be independently managed and versioned so that we can use the right version and the manageability is better on a per package basis. So the advantages everyone knows: independent versioning, independent development and testing can go on. You can work only on selected package. Deployment per package can be simple enough. Of course, you can share code within your organization. If you have just distributed them into libraries and common code that you guys want to share based on packages. But wait, there are some new problems to this. When you break it down, everything on a per package basis seems to be very simple, right? Small and crisp code, small packages to work on, small packages to track. But once you have to package all of that together, integrate it together, and ship the final product to your consumer, that is when the problem arises. Because you might have to make changes across multiple packages and then track them together so that you can integrate them, test them together with your base software, your core software, and then publish it to the end user. And of course, if you have too many packages, you may have, say, like a 10 repositories to check out. Again, a tedious job to keep track of all of them. And now you have packages, so your code is again split up at multiple places. So you may want to look forward to searching your code again, say, across 10 different repositories. So these are some of the problems that do come with the solution of packages. And of course, what are the solutions? Solutions are, we can have two routes. One route is, say, work only on a single repository. Make it that rich and powerful that it has the benefits of like working on one repository, but still gives you the advantages of, say, a multi or a poly package repository. So this is what we term as mono repo. Other option could be use some efficient tools. You keep multiple repositories, but to minimize the overhead of tracking those 10 packages, running your tests across those 10 packages, checking out the versions, when you update one, what others get affected, how do you publish them? Go ahead and make use of some efficient tools like, say, a Git sub module or something like Git sub trees. So today we'll take a look at both of them. How do they differ? What are the powerful tools that are available for us to work on them? I may not go into very detail on each one of them because all of them are an ocean in themselves. So we'll just focus on the core part, how the packages are built up, how they're related, how can you test efficiently? And of course, based on your project requirements, there may be some other stuff that we will face while we code. We can check that on our, say, a day-to-day basis or when we actually fall trapped into that. So mono repo, simple term. Mono means one, repo means repository. So you have just one repository to check out. But if there is only one repository, your organization is huge. You have, say, around 800 developers working. All of them would be committing on that one repository. You may have a lot of Git history, a lot of commits. And since everything is into one repository, a lot of files. So for you, it may be okay. But consider an example, say Git, if it wants to track this repository of a scale, say something like Facebook. A real example, Facebook once had a repository. Their test repository had 1.3 million commits and 44,000 files. So it can be challenging for stuff like, say, even Git, if you have to manage that one repository. So what did Facebook do? They kind of came up with something called as Mercurial. There is a case study on that on the internet. I can leave a link on the chat for everyone to go ahead and read. But if your scale is not that large, say like a Facebook, it's a manageable scale. You know how big your projects can get. Then of course, Monorepo is a very good fit until and unless you keep a check on your scale. So for example, say Babel, the one very famous Babel framework that we all use, React, Vue.js, Angular.js, all of these repositories, if you go ahead and check, they are, all of them are mono repositories. If you can see my screen, just see here, this is Babel repository, GitHub repository, and you see something called as packages. So all those packages that we have been doing an NPM install and registering them on our packages, these are the ones which are listed here. So Babel is a mono repository. Similarly, if you go ahead and check out, say, a React, for example, again, go ahead and see something like packages. All of these Jest, React, DOM, and whatnot that we are known to import them in our code bases, these are all made from a mono repository, React. Now let's go ahead and see what are the tools that are available for us to create a mono repository and manage it. So a very famous tool is Lerna. Another one is Rush. Rush is from Microsoft. So let us see Lerna today, how we can do some example with Lerna. So I'll take Lerna plus Yarn. Yarn, as everyone knows, is again a package manager, as we have NPM. So, and why Yarn? Why not simple NPM? Because Lerna, because Yarn has a concept of workspaces. And that is what is the prime motto here, to break your code into workspaces. Couple them with Lerna, that can give you the power of doing the bookkeeping stuff, like checking which packages get updated when you change one code, and how do you publish all of them. So that part we will see today with Lerna plus Yarn. I'll now go to the demo, and I'll quickly show you first how this demo looks like. I mean, what is it for us to see here in this demo? Oh man, I can't move this. Okay. So I have a very, very simple one-page application, but basically it is composed of three small packages. I'll show you how we are using Lerna and Yarn to actually tie these applications together, and inside your code, how it looks, what it means for us breaking them into packages, and how we can change, publish all these packages using the powerful tool Lerna plus Yarn. Just waiting for it to build. Okay, so we'll go here and say refresh. So if you guys can see my screen, it's a very simple, just a single page application which says a monorepo demo. So if you just see this application, I'll show you what the different parts are. The one that you can see on your screen are is termed as app core, basically the core of my application. And if I hit on the get more button, I basically say load another package, which is essentially an altogether different React project. So it is like running two React instances on my one page. So once I load this, so this is a second React instance that I load. I'll show you in the code. And just take a look at this small subscribe $99 for your text. This is actually consuming a common utils library, which I can consume in my child, which is this you can see now, or in my core package also. So essentially, I have three packages, a core package, a child package, and a utils package. Now let us see what is Lerna, what is Yarn, and how I can package all of them together with these. So I'll show you the code. The demo is simple as enough. Let's see how it looks inside the code. So inside my code, if you see, we have packages directory, right? The same as we saw in React and Babel. So all of these three different things, if you can see clearly, components, core, and utils, these are my three different packages. These can be independent enough React projects or Vue projects, or mix them and match them the way you want. So I have a core package, which is nothing but a simple React project. And I do nothing here except saying, just load a React page for me. That's it, which is just loading a React container. And also I have a components, which you saw, which is just giving you some more text, and a utils package, which just exposes a functionality to just say format currency. That's it. And this is the one that was being used to show you, say, a dollar subscription amount. Okay. Now what you see, how do you create these packages? So first thing is you create a Yarn, you create a package.json file, and you say that I want workspaces. So, and where can the code find my workspaces? Inside a packages folder. So anything which is inside my packages folder is treated as a workspace or an independently managed package, module, submodule, give any terminology you want. Main thing to notice here is private true. This means that my main repository, like I have this main repo, right? And everything inside the packages is the actual code or packages I want to publish or to bring up my app together with. So my main repository, which houses all this git, ignore, Lerna, package, yarn lock, and these packages itself, is not to be published to NPM. This is just helping me in bookkeeping stuff, to tell me what are my dev dependencies, what are the dev dependencies that I will write here, will all be common for all the packages that I have put. So I don't have to worry about putting different dev dependencies inside all of these packages and then have to, you know, fiddle with what are the conflicts between dependencies version, and then somehow rely on, say, a duplicate package checker or the Yarn itself to see how does it resolve. They will have just one copy of all of it. Other stuff, if you go and see, all of my packages, of course, will have a package.json file where I list down what my package name is. So here I have scoped my package name as monorepo demo, and the name is app components. Similarly, different package app core again will have similar terminology, a scoped name, which is monorepo demo, and the actual name is app core. Now, and this is again the same stuff for my third package too. So now if you go ahead and see, when I say yarn, or in terms, there are different commands, I can also say learner bootstrap. What will happen, it will go ahead and check inside package JSON of all these repositories. In app core, I have mentioned, this is simply like adding a repository package. I am saying that app core requires app components from version this. Normally, as you would do, right? Treat your dependencies and say, I want React from version 15, 16, whatnot. So similarly, I have said, whichever package requires whichever code, I am saying, I want this repository here. Also, one thing to note, only dev packages are kept outside as common. The broad dependencies or the dependencies, not the dev dependencies, they will be separate inside each of your package. You have to go ahead and do probably an npm install, but Lerna will take care of you. You just have to learn Lerna, Bootstrap or Yarn, and it does everything for you. It will go inside all the packages and it will check what are all the packages I need to install. It will do it for us in one go. Now, the best part about this is, since everything is declared as a dependency of one another, if I go to my node modules here, if you guys can see node modules, here is the scoped name that I had given, monorepo demo. It's up to you if you want to use scope names, but since I have given, so everything is inside my scope names, all three packages, and all three are symlinks here. So what this means, if I change anyone, I am actually working with the live code of the other one, the live copy of the other one. So I don't have to do, say, specifically something like an npm link or a yarn link. As long as I have everything in my packages, they are auto symlinks. So I don't care about anything. My packages are auto symlinks. A change in one package will bring about a change in other package, as simple as that. So let's quickly make a small change in our package and see how we are benefiting from this. So here I was displaying amount in USD, right? So once you have declared your package as a dependency, see, it's as simple as using a normal import. I will simply say import utils from the app utils, as simple as that. You don't have to do anything else. They are available for you. And now I'm using this function from utils. I can go ahead and change it at runtime and then can say IN, and please show it in INR format. So see, Webpack will auto compile everything. It knows what changed, where it changed. And if I go back to my code now, I should see it right reflecting in my code. Just wait a minute for it to compile. Yes, it's refreshing. Sorry, not sure why my machine is so slow. Okay, so in the meantime, I'll show you what is to use Lerna. What are the other things that you may have to declare? One is, of course, a package JSON. One is also a Lerna JSON. So what you say here in Lerna JSON, you say, Lerna, I'm trying to use packages and you need to take care of all my packages. You need to know where my packages lie. So I tell you, all my packages are available in this path, package slash star. Everything inside this, what I declare, is a package. Versioning scheme independent means I am free to choose my versioning. I am not dependent on, say, a Git system and a fixed terminology of feat, bug, to update the versions automatically based on a major release, minor release, or a patch release. And of course, what my NPM client is, I'm using Yarn. And of course, I'm making use of workspaces. So yeah, this has refreshed. So now if you see here, the symbol is of rupee instead of USD. So it changed on the fly. So these are all interconnected. If I go ahead and now see what changed, that is very simple. Since there is one repository, everything is tracked inside that repository. I know this is what changed. I can go ahead and say, say git commit minus am, say small change. And I can now also, the beauty of this is now I can say Lerna version. Now Lerna knows something changed for me. Okay. So Lerna will say, okay, what changed? You need to tell me. One second, I had to run it outside packages. I will say. So Lerna will give me the ability to tell, to ask me what are the versions that you want to update, because Lerna knows something changed here, right? In the package, I changed my function from I to display the amount in INR and USD. So you come back here and see, now Lerna is asking me, see, you changed app components. What do you want to change it to? Either it's, is it a patch release? Is it a minor release? Shall I update it to say a patch version of 0.41 or a minor of 0.5, or it's a major version 1.0? If I say simply say a minor 0.5, now Lerna knows this component was being used in app core. So app core is also changed. I don't have to manually do this. Discovery of what changed in the packages is the benefit of using Lerna. It is providing me the benefit of saying what all changed in your packages. I will take a look at that. You don't worry. You just keep making changes. I say this also 0.5. Now it says, see, two of your packages changed when you made a change. And these are the versions I'm going to print for you, 5 and 5. Are you okay with this? I will say, yes, I'm okay with this. And the beauty is you don't have to change it. Now, if you go ahead in your code, these packages versions are already changed for you. You don't have to go ahead in your code and say, oh, please update this version number to this. Another thing is all of these packages of you can be published separately onto NPM registry. So you can say publish app core components with a version 5 and the core components with the version 6, because you just updated those versions. So Lerna has a second command, which is called Lerna publish. So once you run Lerna publish, I haven't configured the NPM registry here. So once you say Lerna publish, Lerna will do this everything for you. It will go ahead and publish all of these packages which you have in their separate NPM repositories with the version we just updated. So anyone outside, say there is some other team in my organization which is using my utils package, as a read-only package. They want to know, or there is a React components library that I have built in-house and some other team wants to consume it. They can directly consume it as an NPM library and say an NPM install with that version, because it is already available for me in the NPM registry. Other thing is all these packages, Lerna can do n number of things for you. It will say, please go ahead and I want to test all my packages. So I will simply say Lerna run test and stream. So what Lerna should do, it inside all your packages, if you have configured an NPM test command, the one that you will give in your, say, scripts. So I have a simple test command, which is for now saying, please echo a statement saying running test scripts on app components. So Lerna will go ahead and see inside all of my packages. This is app components. And it is just doing the echo of that, meaning it is running my test script and it is giving me the output. So I have test scripts configured only for two packages, components and core. Both of them are simple echo statements. So Lerna goes in and runs that for me. So once you make your changes as part of your build script or as part of a development cycle, you have to just run simple commands. Say Lerna run test. It will run this test everywhere. In all those packages, you can at once test everything, because everything is a single repository. So this is how Lerna and Yarn will make our life easy in terms of tracking the packages, updating the versions, the discovery of what changed when we actually changed a package or actually made a update in our code base. And you still have the benefit of, say, some third party or a different team in your organization wants to consume your packages. locally, they can continue and doing the simple stuff, or say either a yarn symlink or an npm symlink. That's again open for them to test their changes out if they are not part of your mono repository. So this is how simply Lerna can help us in that bookkeeping task. And with a single repository, you will work with different packages. Those packages, as I said, are fairly independent from each other. They are tied to each other. The coupling is based on the package versions that you install in your each package. And they can be independently versioned on your NPM registry and consumed by either you or someone in your organization who is, again, not having his code base in your mono repo. So this is the advantage of going mono repo route. And as I said, the advantages are fairly simple. You have a uniform versioning scheme. Why? Because there is only one big repository. You don't have a confusion anywhere. And code sharing, as we saw, it is very simple. Code visibility is there because everything is under packages, all the code. So you can anytime go ahead and see what is there in my utils package, what is there in my, say, a common library that we are consuming for a code base. And a large scale refactoring, as I said, you update a code at one place, it auto figures out what changed where, and then it gives you an option to say run tests on them, test everything once, package it together, npm publish all of them together, and then then push everything that you have to your one simple Git repository. So as simple as that. But there can be some challenges. Now these challenges, keep in mind, are based on scale. If your scale is too much, as I said, like the Facebook scale. So here is the link of the case study, as I was mentioning. So if your scale is too much, sometimes what happens, like that happened with Facebook and stuff, the simple commands like git status, they took at least a few minutes, 3 or 4 minutes before they could return the status, because the files they had to track were huge. They were 44,000 files and 1.3 million commits just on a test repository. So think, even those tools have some sort of limitation, right, at a scale that they would work. So you may have to re-engineer that. So this is what Facebook did with Mercurial, something which is similar to Git. And then they created their own in-house sort of a versioning scheme instead of Git. And as I said, once the scale is too large, it may require some extra tooling, because mind here, we have just one repository. And if that repository is in huge number, and even if for a small change, say you will go ahead and check out a small branch, say for my bug-abc or 123, you are actually checking out an entire repository. And the entire Git history, entire log history of that repository is downloaded locally on your machine. So sometimes you may face issues where your editors get slow. Even grep commands find it difficult to hold the entire code bases and do a search on them. So big companies like Facebook, Google, they have their concept of virtual file system, which they have implemented because they want to stick to mono route, and they can afford to leverage that resources, time, and money in their organization to build a virtual file system. They do have that expertise also. So again, as I said, if you can go ahead and you can manage all this stuff, go ahead with the mono repo route. It is a very good solution. But keep in mind that these challenges may come in future if your repository, say, goes out of your hand in reach in terms of size. So this was just a small mono repo demo. It's a very, if you go ahead and read about Lerna and Yarn, there are n number of combinations that we have, so that we can do with them. So feel free to check that out. It was a very small introduction to show this is one route that we can take, a mono repo route. Now let us go to the other route. The other route is Git submodules. If you have any questions, I can stop now and you guys can ask your questions on this, or we can finish both of them and then you can ask if you have.
Yeah, I think anything will work, Ishan. So if anybody has a question, they can ask in between.
Okay, sure. So cool. So I can go ahead with Git submodules then. So this was one route like a big repository can take, right? Maintain just one single repository, mono repo. The other part is keep, again, your packages separate, modules separate in your separate Git repositories, but use an efficient tool, as I mentioned, and Git is a very powerful tool. So this gives you an option to say submodules. Git says this, you can have a parent repository and the other packages which you want, I can help you add them as sub-modules. And I will take care of doing all that stuff that until now we saw Lerna was doing. Like with help of my commands, you can go ahead and say, please go ahead and run test commands in all of my sub-modules. Please go ahead and check the status of all of them. Please go ahead and check out different branch. Because here, now if you have separate repositories, you can play with branches. On one package, you are on a branch, which is feature A. Other, you are on feature B. And third, you are on master. So this, all of this now mix and match, since they are different repositories, you can do, but then rely on Git to see what power Git has to actually help ease your tracking and your manageability of those packages. So quickly go to the Git demo. As I said, the demos are again very simple. The same demo which we had, I will do it with now Git. The same demo, just to show you, there is no change in the demo. Only change will be how these code, how the two codes are tied together. So in the meanwhile, while it boots up, I will show you the Git repository and how it works. So we had three repositories in the other monorepo demo, one which was the core, and the other was components, and third was utils. Here, root is my core, and inside submodules, I have two modules. Child is my component, and utils are utils, the same utils. So here, now I'm asking Git to help me organize this code instead of monorepo and Lerna. So here, there is no yarn, nothing. This is simple Git and NPM doing the job for me. Only thing is, when I create a root package, I will have to tell Git that there are some packages lying on Git. I want you to consider them as a submodule for myself. So you have simple commands to say Git submodule add, and you just give the URL of your Git repository, those child repositories. What Git will do, Git will create this new file for you. We all are familiar with .gitignore. There is a now new file, .gitmodules. So if you go ahead in this file, now is when you see that you have now two submodules added. One is a package child and one is a util. And where can Git find them on the internet, on the network? So these are the complete path of them. So Git knows, okay, this is the path of these packages, and this is where I can go ahead and find them. So yeah, it's ready. Now if you see, I don't know why is it so slow. Yeah. So now if you see, everything is same. Only thing is I have changed the heading to Git submodules instead of monorepo. So just to show exact same application, and I click on get more, I'm loading that component or my child package. Inside that, I'm using the same utils thing which I had. So just how code is organized, how code is managed is now an overhead taken from me away. And I've dumped it onto Git to do that for me. So Git will take care of it, everything now. Now, a very interesting thing here is, whenever you add a submodule and you say Git, please consider this submodule as a submodule for my main repository root. Here in your code base, when you go, you can see entire source code of that. Same as you were in the case of monorepo when you saw. So again, for us, it is very simple, as we are working on, say, a one single code base. What Git has done, it logically, it is organizing them as packages. But if I see it on my editor, I have the full source code. So similarly, if I make change in one package, again, it reflects everywhere. There, what was happening? Symlinks were doing it for me. Here, the code base is one. Only the source is distributed in different files and managed by Git. So once you add a package as a submodule, Git will say, I will track these packages, but from some commit ID. So Git always needs to know what is the commit ID that I am tracking for a sub package. And based on that commit ID, Git will keep showing you the source here, so that there is a one-to-one correspondence between a commit ID, which my child package has, and which is being tracked by my main repository. So in the editor, I see as one code, a simple one code. And I can go ahead and consume it as though I was using a simple code, as you would normally do your simple files with relative import, say dot slash my repository slash this slash that. Here, everything is again, I have done the same way. Only thing is, I have now, instead of saying that I want this version number of that. Here, there is no versioning. Here, it's playing on the Git commits. So I will simply put an alias. I have done an alias. If you want, you can write a complete absolute path starting from source, submodules, package, child, source. So I've just added an alias in Webpack. So I can directly now ask this alias in my code and say, okay, show me what all I need to know. Oh man, what happened? So yeah, how I'll show this in the code, it is very simple. I will go to my, say, a child package, similarly as I did for my other stuff, and I will simply say import same thing. There it was being imported because the code was saying I want this version from components. Here it is just a source of my code which is kept in separate repositories. This is actually a relative path saying ./source your submodules and this package. And similarly, go ahead, you can use the same function, same code base, nothing changes for you, only the way how you import them and you see it from outside changes. Now, why I say Git is tracking it on a commit basis? Because here I can see my complete source, right? If I go here, I can see my complete source for both of these. But this is evident if you go and check your repository. Now, if I go here and check my parent repository, so this is my parent repository, the root one which we have here, right? So this should have a submodule, a source and submodules, and these two submodules. So if I go there in the source and my submodules, now see, we see the commit ID. Now you don't see the source. Source you will only see in your editor when you're working, to give you an idea that this is one code for you. Git is just connecting these two for you based on what the commit ID, your child repository head is at. Okay, so if you have to confirm it, you can go to your child package. You can say, here if you do a git ref parse head, now you see the commit ID. Here is starting from 7D65AD. And this is what is being tracked here, 7D65AD4. For my utils package. So this is what Git is actually tracking it based on a commit ID. But in my editor, I see the full source. So this is just logically separating your source code into different repositories. So you can easily manage them, share the code. If I happen to click on any of these, Git will actually take me to that different repository. Now, if you see, this is a different Git repository, which is my utils repository. And this is the source code I was able to see in my editor. So this is how the Git's magic can help you control your packages and kind of help you update. Now, Git has very good commands. If you similarly, like we were doing in Lerna, if you want to say run a test command here, Git will have a command like git submodule. There is a command called for each. And you can say git, please go ahead and do an npm run test on all of these submodules. So git is entering my utils package. It will do a run of test there, and it will enter my child package. It will do the test there. So like Lerna test was doing, here same echo commands are coming. This is the default echo command. So here the same commands are coming. So git will now help you to do that all testing for that. Just replacing those Lerna commands now with git commands. You can do anything. You can go ahead and say git in every module, please do a git status. Or in every module, say if you're working on some code piece, now see it is showing you in your package child and utils what changed. This is up to date with master, and this is here. Here's one change. So Git will do that magic. If you're working on, say, some code base and you have to work on some urgent bug, you can simply go ahead and say Git stash everything. So in each submodule, it will go ahead and stash it. So now you have leveraged the power of Git to manage all those sub repositories or sub modules. So this is how a mono repo versus a poly repo route are different. How essentially you manage your code, how essentially you publish them, or how essentially you do the code sharing between them. with minimum overhead on your own self, and you leave it to the tools like Git to do it. A similar concept is there, which is called Git subtrees. Almost similar, but commands are different now. So you can go ahead and check that out. That's also one such tool available. So I just wanted to show you an introduction of how these two paths can be different and what is there in store for us if we have to choose one route. So we should be aware what they give us. And as I said, individually, they are an ocean in themselves. So read about them, and they should fit based on your project needs. Like, one size does not fit all, again. So as I said, what are the advantages of Git submodules? Your code can be split into different repositories if you like that. If you are in different repositories, you have a cleaner Git log and history. And you can run all multiple commands with Git submodule for each. You can mix and match branches. You can say, on my utils, I am on a feature branch, something which was not possible with monorepo because there is only one repository. And again, challenges. Like, using Git, of course, can be challenging for like most of us. And it's obviously a breeze for some other smart minds. So it all depends on how you are disciplined with Git, because this will need some extra configuration from our end, and be very sure how we are using Git. As all of us know, Git can be nasty at times. Probably, of course, we mess up, but then to entangle that, it does require a bunch of Google and Stack Overflow or PL's help. So be sure that what you are using. And one kind of a disadvantage, or I would say thing to keep in mind, is that just see here, the repo which is being added, the child repo, the submodule repo, it has no idea that I am being linked as a submodule to some other repository on Git. So the child repos here, as we saw, these child repos, these utils and child, they do not have any idea. Like, if I'm just aware that there is some utils package, I don't know that there is a root package which might be tracking this or might be using this as a submodule. So this is one thing to keep in mind. It may not pose any issues. Of course, within an organization, you can pass that information. But it's just that I feel that if I'm using everything from this powerful tool Git, it should give me some sort of an option to know, okay, who is tracking me and what. May never give you a problem in real life, but just that, to keep in mind, you should know that this is something. And some other problems, like, you may face Git like you face it with your normal code also. Like, suppose today in my organization I want to move some packages to Git submodules. I do it, everything runs fine, great. But tomorrow, if I come back, what happens? I see there is a bug which is on a branch that was cut before the submodules were introduced. Okay, so now you know how do you have to jumble between them and probably do a rebase and stuff if you had to. Or if there were codes that were already being tracked by Git, there is a proper process to move them to submodules. So all those stuff you have to take care of when you're working with Git. Probably a discipline. The more discipline you have with Git, it can be a breeze for you. So
I think there are three questions on a chat.
Sure. Yeah.
So you can look into those. So I think the Shashi is asking, can Lerna tool be used for micro FE?
I don't see the question. Where is it? I missed chat. Something in Lerna. Is this the one?
Yeah, three questions is there. One from...
Okay. Yeah. Can Lerna tool be used for micro front-end architecture? So yeah, I mean... You have to be very sure. See, in micro front-end architecture, you make sure that your code is kind of split into libraries, right? And small services, kind of, you can say. And each services is basically given a task to work on, say, a unit function or a unit functionality. So the way you split them in your packages, it's all on to you, right? How much you put in that package is again up to you. So there are no guidelines around that. So if you are disciplined enough, you know what you are breaking into packages. Of course, like I showed here in the micro frontend architecture, I am actually loading two React instances at one. The other one could very well be a Vue.js or an Angular. And I can load it, say, in the same page or an iframe or a new tab, a new route based on routers that I have on my parent package. I can do it. It's all allowed. It's just how you now design and architect your application. I hope that answers.
Yeah, you can move to the second question.
Cool. The second is, I missed something in Lerna. Will you please tell me, how do you directly import utils package in other package? Of course, yes. One second. Can you see the screen?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so it is simple. You just have to say that I am importing it normally as you would do an import. One second. So this is my code source, my page. So this is how you do it, simply an import. The way you do, you know what your import is doing, right? What is the exported value from that? Is it the exported default value, or if it is some other package? Like here in utils, I have an exported, a simple exported library, which is giving me functions out of the box. I simply say utils.currency. While in my other package, it can be a little different, where I'm loading the component. There, I'm exporting an app in itself. If you see here, yeah, so here if you see, my other packages is giving me an app in itself. So I'm using a dynamic import. I have already listed it down as a package in my package JSON. So I'm just doing a dynamic import, and I know the dynamic import will give me an app. It, like you have a Webpack import, dynamic import, that will give me an export default, which can be a function or an object. And then you can instantiate that function. Probably it will instantiate a React app, Angular app, whatnot. I mean, it's up to your imagination and your code building. So I'm doing that, and then I'm saying, okay, when I get, so here what I'm doing is I have two options. Either I can just import a single component from my other React app, or I can import an app in itself. If I'm on a new route, I might say start from scratch and load another app, as already asked in the micro front end architecture. You can go ahead and do it. This is it. It will simply either import a unit function for you, or it can go ahead and import an entire app. It's all up to you. I hope that answers that. There was one more, right? Can we also work independently on one of the Git submodule without needing to complete setup? I don't understand. If you can be a little more clear on the needing complete setup, what is that setup that is you're talking about?
Hey, Akshay, you want to clarify?
Parent repo and sibling repo. Okay, yes. Yeah. So see, in a parent application, I can be tracking 10 submodules. You're correct. I want to work only on two of them. So all I will do is I will say simply run commands which are like init commands. I will, Git has commands like you will say git submodule init recursively all submodules. It will bring down code from all the submodules, but I want to work only on two of them, right? Or only on one of the submodules. So I will just go into that source of that one module, work on that, commit on that, and push my changes. I don't care what is there in the other submodules as long as I'm not touching them. So I'm absolutely fine on working on either of them. So Git has like beautiful features, like once you do a push, there are commands which will say git push submodule on demand check, or there is something called as on demand and check. So what this does is when you're doing a push, Git will say, you give me an option. I will do a recursive check on all the submodules. If any of the submodules push fails, because there are different repositories, it has to go to different repositories, right? That push will go individually to different repositories. So if one of the push fails, I will fail the entire process. I will not push half stuff in the repositories and then your main is broken. I will not do that for you. I will stop it there and then and tell you, bro, this broke, so I cannot go and proceed. You have to fix a commit, whether there is a merge conflict or a rebase conflict. You first fix it, and then only I will make a complete push. So it is like an all or none scenario. And the second case would be Git can say, automatically you can do with a Git command, say, recursively do a push. And if everything is okay, directly without my intervention, you are free to push to the main repo also. So there are a lot of flags and commands that Git has to offer to us, which we can leverage, right, based on our experience. And they are not difficult. They might seem a little tricky at once because we are accustomed to a single repo, the submodule concept, those recursive stuffs are difficult. So once you're okay with that, just create a Git alias for all of them in your Git config files, right? And share them. So you don't have to fiddle with them each day, and there is no chance in going wrong with any command. So yeah, that can be done. Hope that answers it, bro.
Cool. Yeah, so any more question, I think you can ping Ishan directly also. I think, can I get Lerna demo project Git repo? I think, yeah, I think Ishan will.
I can share the repo links of both of them. They are on my shared on my GitHub, and I can share them. And if you want to connect, here is I am on Twitter, LinkedIn, and Medium. So if you want, just go ahead and connect with me, and I will share those links with Patro and even in the chat. So please go ahead and feel free to check those repositories out and feel free to play with them. The code may have little extra because I was playing with those repo with other stuff too. So feel free to check them out. If you have any questions, we can collaborate and take it forward.
Sure. Thank you, Ishan. I think it was a pretty interesting topic. I find it useful because I have not used those on day-to-day basis what you have demoed. So I hope it was useful for others also. So what we'll do, we'll move to our second session, which because interrupted because of network issues. So I'll pull Anisha here. Just give me a moment. Hey, Anisha, are you able to hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Cool. So you can share your screen and we'll see if everything goes good, then we'll continue. Otherwise, we'll see what other option we can have. So Ishan, thank you very much for your session. So I'm just removing you from stage. Anybody has any question, they can directly